morning, people. I hope you're doing well, my lovelies, because I have a gift for you. And it may contain science. Crafty science. Personally, I've been getting more into crafting lately. I crocheted my first blanket a few weeks ago, I've got a scarf I'm struggling with, and I received some knitting needles for Hanukkah that I'm looking forward to putting to good use. But in my newfound fiber arts journey, I've discovered that one surprising sticking point in project selection is yarn. There's acrylic, wool, cotton, bamboo, polyester, all the different properties, sustainability advantages and disadvantages. Dang, I've got these knitting needles and no idea what yarn to knit with them. What the heck should I use to make my ugly holiday sweater? Well, this is May Contain Science, and science has delivered an answer to this conundrum. One that, I admit, I would not have seen coming in a zillion years. Science, that is, the journal Science, suggests Aerogel. Yes, that Aerogel, beloved of YouTubers and science museum gift shops worldwide. Invented in 1931 on a bet, Aerogels start life as a normal gel, most often a silica gel, but they poke evolve into aerogels by removing the liquid. Now, if you just stuck a gel in the hot sun and let the liquid evaporate, the gel would pretty much deflate as the colloidal matrix that gives gel its semi-solid structure collapses. But if you freeze dry the gel, or do the opposite, supercritical drying right at the boundary between liquid and gas, the solid matrix holds its shape, but all the liquid is replaced by, well, air. The result is an ultra-light, ultra-low-density solid that is usually about 97% air. It feels not unlike styrofoam in that, like, weirdly light kind of way, and despite the name, it is absolutely not squishy. In fact, one of the notable characteristics of most aerogels is that, until some recent advances, aerogels are super brittle, and if you smoosh them, most formulations like classic silica aerogel will crumble or shatter. If you stretch them, well, it works about as well as stretching styrofoam. But aerogels have some fantastic properties that make them well worth the non-smooshy disadvantages. Most notably here, aerogels are really, really, really good insulators. They tend to be mostly transparent, owing to the whole 97% air thing or white, and infrared radiation will largely pass right through most of them. They also don't conduct heat well because they're mostly air. And while in an open space, air will transfer heat due to convection, the solid part of aerogels nerf convective heat transfer as well, as the solid structure doesn't give the air inside it much room to maneuver. This gives it the best of both worlds in terms of thermal insulation, and we can already see why NASA loves aerogels. They're super lightweight, so you can get a ton of this really high quality thermal insulator into space without burning a heck ton of rocket fuel to do it. Mars rover? Insulated with aerogel. Heat shields for atmospheric reentry? Sure, throw some aerogel on it. EVA suits gotta protect astronauts from the unforgiving environment of space? Yeah, you saw it coming. We're doing it with aerogel. So, despite its non-smooshy, non-stretchy limitations, aerogel is one of those awesome 20th century materials with tons of applications, but I admit, I took aerogel for what it was. But these scientists out of Zhejiang University in China saw aerogel for what it could be. A sweater. At first, yeah, you might think, aerogel sweater. Aerogel sweater? How did their brains even get there? And in retrospect, the answer is obvious. They were inspired by polar bears. Of course. No, seriously, it's not where my mind would jump, but it does make some sense. The polar bear stays warm in the ridiculously cold Arctic by one, being an absolute unit, of course, but two, Their fur is structured not wholly unlike aerogel. It's aerogel, if you will. Here is a cross-section of a single hair of polar bear fur examined through a microscope. You can see how it's actually hollow, allowing for that air-filled phenomenon that makes it a poor conductor of heat, but it's also got all of these mushroom gill-like microstructures inside it to trap air and prevent convective movement. And if you've ever heard polar bear fur is actually clear, then you may be guessing that it has limited infrared absorption for radiative heat transfer, and you'd be right. Meanwhile, the outer shell of the hair gives it strength and prevents it from being too porous, especially considering how these guys will take a swim pretty often. But it would have been one thing to make maybe like a faux fur out of stiff little fibers of aerogel to sort of approximate polar bear fur. That's not easy, but maybe then at least you're looking at shorter strands of the little stuff that won't be too annoying if a few of them break off. But yarn requires all the properties that aerogel lacks. Long, ultra-flexible strands so you can knit it up and give it to your loved ones and they have to pretend they love it. Over the years, various aerogels have seen improvements in compressive strength. NASA loves to show off this polyamide aerogel that supports the weight of a car, and as we see, that type of formulation can be cast as a flexible sheet. But according to the same NASA material science talk these pictures came from, polyamide aerogel tends to shed dust with handling, and we've had more than enough sweaters that shed all over us. So, how did this group manage to make a yarn that isn't just flexible, but stretches? The technique is called freeze spinning, which is a variation on the freeze drying technique we talked about at the beginning of the story. Using chitosan as the gel solute, which is a fibrous sugar made from chitin exoskeleton that played the role of silica or polyamide or whatnot in this aerogel, the solution was then extruded through a syringe and through a cold copper ring to freeze it, then further freeze-dried. Fiber artists might take the opportunity to note there's not a lot of spinning in the way that someone who works with wool might define it, but this is more like spinneret extrusion, so we'll count it for now. Freeze-spinning. 48 hours later, now you have an aerogel fiber. Congratulations! While this approach isn't novel in the material science world, this is one of the standard operating procedures for aerogel fiber production, apparently a thing, but it is still, even after all this, a terrible yarn. Not only does it have all those brittle properties we've been talking about, but aerogel's absolute garbage at dealing with moisture. With silica aerogel, you actually have to wear gloves because it'll suck the moisture right out of your skin. And with many aerogels, they don't survive contact with the enemy. The enemy, in this case, being water. Here's what our freeze-spun mediocre yarn looks like before contact and after. It's as if it remembered it used to be a gel, and when it dries by conventional evaporation, it deflates, as if disappointed in its life path. What a relatable little fiber. But now, our group leverages the other aspect of polar hair, the outer shell. Remember how that shell gives polar bear fur water protection and additional strength? We just have to give our yarn an outer shell. These researchers accomplished that by dipping the aerogel fiber in a thermoplastic elastomer solution, encapsulating the aerogel in a shell that is, conveniently, highly elastic, transparent, and quite waterproof. Now look at the result as it dries. The aerogel fiber doesn't deflate because the moisture never reaches the porous inner layer. And because aerogel's insulating properties still work perfectly well when encapsulated like this, You get all the advantages of aerogel's thermal properties, but now in a form factor that mitigates its disadvantages and supplements its tensile strength, allowing it to stretch up to 1000% strain compared to traditional aerogel fibers that are good for about 2%. The result is apparently dyeable as long as you add the dye in the freeze-spinning part of the process, and for at least the couple cycles they tested, it's machine washable. So, this is all well and good and a fun advancement that cracks a tough problem in material science. But I didn't promise you a skein of waterproof stretchy yarn. I promised you a Goram sweater. And let no one say I don't deliver. Or rather that our scientists don't. This delivers the same insulation as down, for 1/5 the thickness. It has better performance than wool at half the thickness and absolutely destroyed nylon and PET at the game, assuming the game is staying warm. Now, there's a bit of inconsistency in the title versus the body of this paper as to whether the body of the sweater was knitted or woven. The material section doesn't clarify. And if you're not a crafting nerd, let me tell you, there is a difference. We have no indication that this particular aerogel sweater was hand-knit, and frankly, it looks like it would be a tough job to do so. But I do relish the mental image of a grad student with some circular needles working on the sleeves while being rushed along by their advisor to knit faster! Publish or perish? Old news. It is purl or perish now. The study's authors point out that their fabrication technique is pretty intensive, so this would be limited to specialized applications for now, rather than mass textile productions. And hopefully as we solve that problem, it gives us time also to improve other materials involved in manufacture, like improving our plant-based biodegradable thermoelastic elastomers so we can enjoy our warm, lightweight sweaters as sustainably as possible. So what are you gonna knit out of aerogel first? I'm thinking cardigan.